A fractal is a geometrical object that looks similar on all scales. They're beautiful figures, and we're going to use Newton's method to generate what is one of the nicest fractals. That's to use Newton's method to find the cube roots of unity. So a cube root of unity then is a solution to the equation z cubed equal to 1. We're talking about complex numbers here, so it's good to have a representation of where are the cube roots of unity. If I draw the unit circle in the complex plane, so this is the real part of z, this is the imaginary part of z, then the cube roots of unity lie on the unit circle. And one of them is 1. 1 cubed is equal to 1. So 1 lies here on the real axis. The other two are equidistributed on the unit circle. And one of them is here, and the other one is here. So they all have the same spacing. If you multiply this complex number by itself, then you spin around the unit circle to this lower x, and you multiply it again, so you're taking the cube, and then you get to 1, okay? If you multiply this lower complex number by itself, you spin around to this upper complex number, and then you multiply it by itself again, and you get 1. So those are the three cube roots of unity. We can find a expression for them if we use Euler's formula. So Euler's formula is cosine theta plus I sine theta is this e to the I theta, so a complex exponential function. So how do we use Euler's formula here? We can write 1 as e to the I 2 pi, and then we can square that or cube that. So we can write the equation z cubed equals 1 as z cubed equals e to the I 2 pi times n, where n is an integer. Then we can go ahead and take the cube root. So then we get the cube roots of unity are e to the I 2 pi n divided by 3. Okay? There are three unique values here. N equals 0, so that would be the solutions would be z equal to n equal to 0 is e to the 0, which is 1. So one of the solutions is 1. We'll call that R1, okay? The other solution is n equals 1, which is e to the I 2 pi over 3. E to the I 2 pi over 3, that's this upper red cross. If you use Euler's formula, then that's cosine 2 pi over 3 plus I sine 2 pi over 3. If you remember your trig identities, that would be minus 1 half plus I square root of 3 divided by 2. And I'll call that the second cube root of unity. The third one is n equal to 2, so e to the I 4 pi over 3. And that's this lower x here. And plugging into Euler's formula, that would be minus 1 half minus I root 3 over 2. And that would be R3. Okay. So we know what our three cube roots of unity are. So how do we get a fractal from this? Well, what we do is we look at the complex plane here and consider the convergence of Newton's method to initial conditions in the complex plane. So let's write down Newton's method. So we have to solve an equation f of z equal to 0. Here, f of z then is equal to z cubed minus 1. To implement Newton's method, we need the derivative. The derivative of a polynomial is very simple. That's 3z squared. And Newton's method is the iteration z n plus 1 equals z sub n minus f of z sub n over f prime of z sub n. Okay? So what we're going to do to generate our fractal is to grid up the complex plane. And at the center of each grid point, let's say, for instance, here, we're going to call that z naught. Then we're going to ask which cube root of unity will z naught converge to when we iterate Newton's method. Okay? If it converges to R1, then we're going to color this pixel representing z naught a certain color. Let's see what is our coloring scheme going to be. So if z naught converges to R1, we're going to color the pixel red. Okay. On the other hand, we will have another z naught. Say maybe we'll have a z naught over here. Okay, so that will be a different z naught. If that converges to R2, so if z naught converges to R2, we're going to color the pixel green. Okay, and then maybe another z naught over here close to R3. Right? If that z naught converges to R3, then we're going to color the pixel blue, right? RG blue scheme. Okay, where does the fractal come from? The fractal comes from the neighborhood of the region where you're kind of close to R1 and R2. So somewhere in this mid area, or the region where you're close to, equally close to R3 and R1, right? R1 and R2, or between R2 and R3. So in those borderline regions, we're going to see something extremely interesting, which is a fractal. And when you zoom into the pixels in that region, you'll see similar pictures on a smaller scale. It's a beautiful figure. In the next video, I'll show you how we can use MATLAB to generate such a fractal. I'm Jeff Chasnoff. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.